Hello, welcome to Free Bible Commentary with Pastor Teacher Dr. Bob Utley. Be sure to visit Free Bible Commentary at www.freebiblecommentary.org. Now, here's Bob.
We're going to be doing the prophecy of Obadiah. That's one of those books where you have to turn to Ezekiel and take a right, and you'll find it in just a minute. It's only one chapter long. It's probably the least known as well as the shortest of the Old Testament books. But I think, though, it has a real message not only for its own day, which we're going to kind of try to find but aren't going to be sure, as well as end time. So let's look at it. The prophet's name is Obadiah. Now, that means servant of Yahweh or worshiper of Yahweh, so it can be a title or a name. Now, the name is a very common Old Testament name. It's mentioned several times. Let me give you some. 1 Kings 18:3, 1 Chronicles 3:21, 7:3, 8:38, 9:16, 9:44, 12:9, 27:19, 2 Chronicles 17:7, 34:12, Ezra 8:9, Nehemiah 10:5, 12:25. So obviously it's a very common name, so I think it's a name, not a title here. Now, because of the first chapter, down and about where it says, I heard, many think, verse 1, that he was a Judean. But the Septuagint has, I heard, instead of we heard, so even him being from Judea is not a certainty. There have been several theories about the author here. The Talmud, in its tractate on the Sanhedrin, 39, section B, says he is the servant of King Ahab, and that'd be 1 Kings 18:3 through 16. A later church writer has said that he was a high military official in the reign of, Abaziah, which would be 2 Kings 1, 12 and following. And John Calvin says that he is an eyewitness to the destruction of Jerusalem. Well, all of these are uncertain, but I think Calvin is probably the closer than the other two, for the date seems to be post-exilic. And that's what we're going to come to now. Let's look at the date of the prophecy. Now, there are several things involved, external evidence and internal evidence. Let's first look at the internal evidence. It is obvious that the book of Obadiah is related to two other Old Testament passages. Jeremiah 49, verses 7 through 22, and Joel, verse 2, verse 32. Now, R.K. Harrison, who does an introduction to the Old Testament that I think is one of the best available, puts the order of the relationship this way. Jeremiah, Obadiah, and Joel. This makes the book post-exilic. Now, most modern commentators would follow that understanding of this book being after the exile. Now, it is obvious that the book relates to an invasion of Judah by Edom, or at least by someone where Edom participated in the invasion. There have been several possible dates. Let me give you some of them where this could be the background setting. Number one, Jerusalem was taken by Shishak, Pharaoh of Egypt, in the fifth year of Rehoboam, 1 Kings 14:25 through 28, and 2 Chronicles 12:2 through 10. Jerusalem was taken by an Arab League and the Philistines in the reign of Jehoram, and that would be 2 Chronicles 21:16 and 17 in chapter 22:1. The third would be Jerusalem was taken by the Syrians in the reign of Joash, and that would be 2 Chronicles 24. 23 and 24. Number four, Jerusalem was taken by Israel, and that's Jehoash, the king of Israel, after the defeat of Edom in the reign of Amaziah, and that'd be 2 Kings 14, 7 through 14. Judea was attacked by the Edomites, and that's in 2 Chronicles 28:17, 29, 8 and 9, and 2 Kings 16, 1 through 20. And finally, and I think this is probably the accurate one, Jerusalem was taken by Nebuchadnezzar II two times, first in 597 B.C., and then it was totally destroyed in 586 B.C. in the reign of Jehoiachin, 2 Kings 24, 13 through 16, 2 Kings 25, 4 through 17, and 2 Chronicles 36, 18 through 20. Now, most commentators feel like that the most accurate description of Obadiah would be Nebuchadnezzar II in the destruction of Jerusalem. Now, Obadiah is against the nation of Edom. And, of course, Edom is the from the man Esau, and he's the brother of Jacob. And it goes back to Genesis 25, 26 through there, where this animosity dealt with. Now, the reasons for the judgment against Edom are basically, number one, they rejoiced at their brother's demise, or Judah's demise. That'd be Psalms 137, 7, Lamentations 4, 21, Lamentations 2, 15 through 17, Ezekiel 36, 2 through 6, and the apocryphal book of 1 Esdras chapter 4, verse 45 and 50. And also, Edom seemed to help the Babylonians in the destruction of Judah. And that would be Ezekiel 25, 12 through 14, and Ezekiel 35, 1 through 15. Now, the object of the prophecy is the nation of Edom. The chapter seems to be broken into two parts. Verses 1 through 14 relate to the nation of Edom, and in 15 through 21 use Edom as an example of a world empire that God's going to judge. Okay? Edom is the nation east of the Dead Sea from Esau, Jacob's brother, Genesis 25 through 29 and 32 and 33. Now, Edom means red, while Esau means hairy, but they're both related in Genesis 25, 25 and 30. It seems that Edom's name is related to the red stew that Jacob made when Esau sold his birthright, Genesis 25, 30. And the word for calamity in verse 13 is also a play on the word red. Now, Israel was commanded to respect its brother Esau, Deuteronomy 23, 7. But Edom violated that trust, and we see that there are continuing problems between these two nations throughout the Old Testament. Numbers 20, verses 14 through 21, Judges 11, 16 and following, 1 Samuel 14, 47 and 48, 2 Samuel 8, 14, 1 Kings 11, 14 through 25, 2 Kings 14, 22, and 2 Kings 16, 5 and 6, 2 Chronicles 20, 10 through 30, and 2 Chronicles 21, 8 and following. There's an allusion to it in Amos 1, verses 6, 9, and 11. Now, Obadiah is not the only Old Testament prophecy that deals with the nation of Edom. There's Isaiah 34, 5 and following, Isaiah 63, 1 and following, Jeremiah 49, 7 through 22, which is almost exactly like verses 1 through 9 of Obadiah, Lamentations 4, 21 and 22, Ezekiel 26, 12 and following, 35, 1 and following, and 36, 2 through 6, and then Amos chapter 1, verses 11 and 12. Now, if I could go over the book real quickly as far as a basic little outline, Edom is condemned for several things. Number one, her pride in verses 3 and 4, and she was basically prideful about four things. Her geographical security, her political alliances and military power, her commercial wealth, and her traditional wisdom. Now, the second reason for Edom being condemned is her violation of her kinsman, Judah, verses 10 through 14. First, she rejoiced over the fall of Jerusalem, Lamentations 2, 15 through 17, and Lamentations 4, 21. And she refused to help her brother in time of need, verse 15. She gave active support to the enemy, verse 14. And she took Judah's prophecy, Jeremiah 13, 19. And number three, she's rejected because of her disdain for Yahweh, and that's in verse 16. Edom is a symbol for all nations as they come against God's power. Matter of fact, in the rabbis, Edom becomes a name for the enemies of God. Now, some possible fulfillments of this destruction of Edom, there are several possibilities. Number one is the destruction of Edom by Neo-Babylon about 5 years after the fall of Jerusalem, around 580. This displacement of Edom from its very famous capital, Petra, by the Nabatean Arabs around 550 to 400 B.C. You might want to see Malachi chapter 1, verses 2 through 5. Edom is not mentioned in Nehemiah about the surrounding nations that opposed the rebuilding of the temple. The other ancient tribes are mentioned, but Edom is not, so the Arabs must have already taken her over. The defeat of Edom by Alexander the Great's general Antiochus in 312 B.C., the defeat of Edom by Judas Maccabeus around 175 B.C., we find that in 1 Maccabees 5:3 and 5:15, and 2 Maccabees 10:15, and Josephus' book, The Antiquities of the Jews, section 12:8:1 and section 13:9:1, okay? And finally, the defeat of Edom, which by that time is known as Idumea, which is going to be the hometown of Herod, home area, by John Hyrcanus in 125 B.C. Now, that's a quick overview of the book as far as the historical setting. Now, let's look at the book itself. Verse 1, the vision of Obadiah. Now, vision means a divinely communicated truth. Obadiah means the servant of Yahweh. Says the Lord God. This is the word Adonai Yahweh. Usually Adonai is the word Lord in small letters, and Yahweh in the English Bible is the word Lord in capital letters. When they appear together, it sounds a little redundant in English, so it's usually called Lord God concerning Edom, and that's, of course, the nation east of the Dead Sea from Jacob's brother Esau. All right? Now, we have heard. Now, that's what they say that he's a Judean, but the Septuagint has, I heard a report from the Lord. An envoy has been sent among the nations saying, arise, let us do battle, let us go against her for battle. Now, again, the three reasons are her pride, her violating her brother, and her arrogance against Yahweh. All right? And behold, I will make you small among the nations. You are greatly despised. The word behold is a prophetic perfect. They're all the way through this book. We're not sure if it's past or contemporary or future. We just can't set a date based on these prophetic perfects. Now, the arrogance of your heart. The word arrogance means to boil. And this is a play maybe back in Genesis 25 on Jacob making this red boiling soup where he's going to buy the birthright from Esau. It's maybe a play on that. Now, it says the clefts of the rock. The loftiness of your dwelling place. Edom was in a very mountainous country, and it was natural fortresses. Matter of fact, her first capital was Bozrah, we learn from Jeremiah 49:22. But her later capital is called Sela, which is Aramaic for rock. And we know it by the Greek name Petra, a formidable rock fortress, and yet it is going to fall. You see a mention of this rock fortress in 2 Kings 14:7. Now down in verse 4. Although you build high like an eagle, though you set your nest among the stars. Well, boy, that sounds rather idealistic, set your nest among the stars. Pride is always condemned in the Bible. Matter of fact, the king of Babylon, mentioned in Isaiah 14, and the king of Tyre, mentioned in Ezekiel 28, are used as an example of earthly pride that foreshadowed the angelic pride of Satan that caused the original rebellion against God. Now, in verse 5 it says, thieves and robbers and grape gatherers. Now, the time is uncertain, but it's obvious that this is such a cleansing that they're not going to leave anything. They're not going to rob something. They're going to take everything. This is almost like a scorched earth policy in battle. Now, there's been some debate on which this is. Is it the Neo-Babylonian army, or is it the Nabataean Arabs, or is it the Greek general Antigonus, or is it Judas Maccabees and John Hyrcanus? We don't know, but Edom was judged completely and destroyed. Now, notice, if you would, where it mentions in verse 6, oh, how Esau will be ransacked and his hidden treasures searched out. Now, this hidden treasure seems to be an allusion to Edom's economic power or riches. Now, she was rich from several areas. She had a famous copper mines I believe they're Eben Gezer, which is on the Gulf of Aqaba, and she had very fertile soil, and she was also on the trade route, which means she made caravans pay taxes, but that's going to be completely taken for her. Now, verse 7 is very difficult in English. If you'll get several English translations, you'll see how hard it is to translate. But it seems that people she trusted in and had a covenant with are going to betray her. And that's exactly what happened to her brother Judah, and she would not help. And so now she's reaping exactly what she sowed. But it seems to be that a covenant is broken by her friends or military alliances. And look at the last of verse 7. It's a surprise to Edom that she's overthrown. She wasn't expecting it. And yet it happens to her just as it happened to Judah. Now, In verse 8 is the first use of the little phrase, will I not on that day, declares the Lord, destroy the wise men from Edom? Now that day is a phrase that begins a play. In verses 10 through 14, it's a play on temporal judgment. But in verses 15 through 21, this same that day or that day of the Lord is a play on God's eschatological judgment. So Edom is going to be judged because of her arrogant pride as a world power. Not a real world, but an enemy of the people of God. But she's used as an example of the haughty pride of man against God that will one day be crushed. Now, when it says the wise men from Edom, one of Job's three friends, Eliphaz, is from Teman, which is mentioned in the next verse, which is one of the southern cities of Edom. Now, that's in Job 2:11. So there's a traditional wisdom that is connected with the nation of Edom, an understanding from the mountain of Esau. Now, the mountains of Esau, originally in Genesis, they took this area over from the Horites, sometimes called the Troglodytes, they changed the name to Mount Seir, verse 8, 9, 19, and 21. In this prophecy, Mount Seir is played off against Mount Zion, and that's kind of a play on these two. Now, when it mentions here in verse 9, the city of Teman, we get that from Jeremiah 49:7, this same use. It means south in Hebrew. It seems to be a city named after the grandson of Esau, Genesis 36:11-15:42. But it also was a title for a region of Edom, and so it's kind of a play on that. Notice it says, "And are that everyone be cut off from the mountains of Esau by slaughter." Now, for some reason, the Septuagint takes the word by slaughter and makes it the beginning of verse 10. Now, which is true, I'm not real sure. "Because of the violence to your brother Jacob." Now, Israel was commanded not to hurt Edom in Deuteronomy 23:7. But Edom took advantage of that. And we see this beginning tension in these two brothers, Genesis 25-29 and 32 and 33. And it's so the reason she's judged because she broke a covenant with a kinsman, which in the ancient Near East was a very, very terrible act, okay? "You will be covered with shame. You will be cut off forever. On that day, you will stand aloof. On that day, strangers carried off his wealth, and foreigners entered his gate and cast lots for Jerusalem." Now, this is the place we believe that Edom helped the invading Babylonian army. The only real corroboration for that we have is 1 Esdras chapter 4, 45 and 50. You might want to look at that. Now, the idea about casting lots for Jerusalem means dividing the spoil of the enemy that actually took the city. The same metaphor is used in Joel 3:3 and Nahum 3:10. "You too were one of them, part of that invading army." Verse 12, "Do not gloat over your brother's day, the day of his misfortune, and do not rejoice over the sons of Judah in the day of their destruction. Yes, do not boast." There are several passages in the Old Testament where Edom was glad when Judah was hurt. For there had been tension between these countries, and during David and Solomon, the Edomites were kept under subjection. Even in the divided monarchy, most of that period, the Judeans kept Edom under their thumb, and so there was a real animosity there. We see it in Psalms 137:7, Lamentations 2:15-17, Lamentations 4:21, Ezekiel 36:2-6, and 1 Esdras 4:45-50. Now in verse 13, there's the word calamity, which is another play on the word Edom, or red. You mean Adam and Edom are very close. Adam means red clay, Edom means red. And here it's the idea of the blood from swords is the play on calamity we find in Ezekiel 35:5. And verse 14, "And do not stand at the fork of the road to cut down their refugees, and do not imprison their survivors in the day of distress." This seems to be that Edom, knowing the mountain passes, the way of escape from Judah, when the invading Neo-Babylonian army came, they guarded these mountain passes, kind of an ambush, and captured the Judeans who were trying to flee. They either made them their slaves, or they turned them back over to the Babylonian army. And we're not real sure which happened. Now, verse 15 is an obvious transition. We're using Edom as an example of a world power that's against God. Look what it says. "For on the day of the Lord," that is an eschatological phrase for the day of judgment, okay? "Draws near on all the nations." You catch the universal implications there on all the nations? As you have done, it'll be done to you, and your dealings will return to your own head. Well, that's very much like the New Testament principle found in Matthew 7:2 and Galatians 6:7. We reap what we sow. We have a cultural idiom we call, if we live by the sword, we'll die by the sword. Well, that's the same truth here. They're going to reap what they've sown now from God. The idea of God's moral judgment is something that developed in the Old Testament when people realized that life is unfair, that the history is unfair, and they believe God's going to set it straight. Well, if history is unfair and it's not set straight in a man's lifetime, when will it will be set straight? Well, that's when an afterlife begins to develop, that God's going to set it straight in the next stage, in the next life. And that's the idea, I think. Because as you drink on my holy mountain, that's the allusion to Zion, all the nations will drink continually, and they will drink and swallow and become as if they had never existed. Now, this seems to be where they despise Yahweh by drinking in the destroyed city of Jerusalem, a toast to the destruction or something. Now, this idea about drinking as a metaphor of judgment is throughout the Old Testament. The word cup or the word to drink is an idea of judgment. Let me give you a few. Psalm 75:8, Isaiah 51:17 and 22, Jeremiah 25:15 and 16, and verses 27 and 28, Ezekiel 23:32 through 34, Matthew 20:22 and 23, Matthew 26:39 and 42, John 18:11, and Revelation 14:16, 16:19, and 19:15. The idea about Jesus taking the cup of God in the Garden of Gethsemane, that's the idea of the judgment. The cup was a sign of God's judgment. Now in verse 17, but on the mountain of Zion. Now this, of course, is a name for Jerusalem. Now, the temple was not built on Mount Zion. That's the site of the ancient Jebusite fortress that David took. But the temple was built on Mount Moriah, where Abraham offered Isaac in Genesis 22:1. But Mount Zion came to be a title for the whole city of Jerusalem, which is really on several different mountains. Notice it mentions the house of Jacob and the house of Joseph. Notice there's going to be a reuniting of the Jewish people, okay? Now we'll see Psalm 77:15. Now in verse 17 where it says, Jacob will possess their possessions, there's a real possible Hebrew translation of Jacob will possess those who dispossessed them. And that may be the idea of the redeemed of the Lord possessing the earth, and maybe an allusion to that. Now in verse 18, C, it says, but the house of Esau will be stubble. This allusion to fire as a means of judgment and stubble as that which men build away from God is found, first of all, in Exodus 15:7, then in Matthew 3:12, and again in 1 Corinthians 3:10 through 15. John the Baptist's message was that he'd bring fire and judge. And then, of course, in 1 Corinthians 3, it's the idea about a man who built. He was a true Christian, but he built with wood, hay, and stubble, and judgment day burned it all away, and he got no reward, though he himself was saved. It's a biblical evidence for backslidden Christians, I guess. And they will set them on fire and consume them, so there'll be no survivor of the house of Esau, for the Lord has spoken. So it's really a judgment using Esau on human government functioning apart from God. And that's really the biblical definition of the word world. In the New Testament, there are three enemies of man: the world, the flesh, fallen nature, and Satan. And the world is human society organized and functioning apart from God, which Babylon is a type, and here Edom is a type. Now in verses 19 through 21, we have a geographical expansion of the people of God back to the limits of the old promise to Abraham. In 19, the word Negev is mentioned. This means the south country in Hebrew, and it's the area south of Beersheba, okay? Notice in verse 19 it says, the Sheplah. Now this is the low rolling hills that go to the coastal plains, okay, where the Philistines used to live. There's a coastal plain all along Palestine, and that's the ideal of Sheplah, okay? Possess the territory of Ephraim and Samaria. Now these are two titles for the northern 10 tribes, Ephraim, Samaria, or Israel. So they're going to, that Judah is going to possess all that, the people of God reunited. And Benjamin will possess Gilead. Now, Gilead is in the Transjordan area. It's famous for its cattle, a very rich area. It'd be modern Jordan where it would be. and the exiles of the host of the sons of Israel, who were among the Canaanites as far as Zarephath. And you can see how that's a geographical location. And the exiles of Jerusalem who are in, now my translation has S-E-P-H-A-R-E-D. It seems to be a metaphor for the farthest exiles that are going to be brought home. There's been much fight in history over exactly what this geographical location is. Some think from a Persian inscription that it's the capital of Lydia, which would be modern Turkey. Others say it's the islands off Libya. Some say Media, because of some inscriptions from Sargon and Esarhaddon, Assyrian inscriptions. Some say it's Spain, and that would be the rabbis and the Targums and the Peshitta. Others say it's the Bosporus, and that would come from the Latin Vulgate. And some say it's Sparta, and that would come from Kyle and Delitzsch. So you can tell, it's just, we don't know where it is, but it's a metaphor for the farthest exiles are going to be brought home. Now notice in verse 21, the deliverers will ascend Mount Zion. Now the Septuagint has those who have been saved, those who have been delivered, not spiritual, but physical, and that may be true, to judge the mountain of Esau. Notice the mountain of Esau in contradistinction from the mountain of Zion. And the kingdom will be the Lord's. And of course, the book ends on a very strong note, apparently a messianic note, that God is going to possess the earth. This is the same allusion that the kingdom of God is going to take over the kingdoms of men. When Jesus prayed in the Lord's Prayer, "Thy kingdom come," you know, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," he was praying for the kingdom of God to come. Now, we know that the kingdom came when Jesus was born in Bethlehem. It's already here. Now, it's not going to be consummated until Jesus comes back. But that's the idea of the reign of God in some men's hearts now. But one day, it'll be over all men. And that's the idea here of the kingdom will be the Lord's. And notice the word Lord is in all caps. It's the covenant name for God, Yahweh, from the Hebrew verb to be, Exodus 3:14. And it's the idea that he is the king. He has always been the king. And he still is. God's on his throne. Edom's not going to defeat his people. These world powers aren't going to defeat his people. God's going to bring to pass his will in the lives of men and nations. I've enjoyed being with you, and I'll see you again, same time, same place, next week.